In America, there are mainly from the wild animals, like civet, raccoons, they have so-called eliminated canine rabies. So we are yet to eliminate this one. And so far, we are very lucky. We have, I think, more than 20 cases of bitten by dogs. We have not yet a single human case of rabies. So in other words, we still maintain the records. Of course, we have to treat. I think one of the speakers mentioned that when people come to us, we do the assessment. We have to do assessment and then give the vaccination. Rabies vaccination is very unique. When talking about vaccination, normally you talk about pre-exposure. Yes, can be used, but it can also be used for treatment. That's why they call it PET, post-exposure treatment. And on top of that, we also give hyperimmune serums. In Malaysia, we use equine. We don't really use other serums. So we maintain that record. Anybody bitten, of course, you have to do assessment. Normally, the second degree or third degree, you have to check. Dog bite, they got classification into certain categories lah, whether scratch or deep wounds. They give the hyperimmune serum, equine rabies immunoglobulin, and also rabies vaccines lah. Of course, they can schedule. And if possible, the dog being if caught by the veterinary department, we will get the news whether that need to be continued, because the rabies vaccine you have to give 0, 3, 7, 14 and 28 days lah. If they say that the dog is not rabid, then we stop there. If a rabid, then that's very, very costly actually. It's not the way to go lah. We should eliminate rabies in the, as for the culling and the vaccination, I think already discussed, I don't want to say into details lah. Of course, they got pros and cons lah. During the outbreak, we have to do certain things more drastic lah compared to the when you want to maintain the dog, canine rabies free in dog. Okay, so talking about animals infectious, yeah, because not all animals are healthy, like humans, isn't it? Not all are healthy. So some harbor pathogens. So when we come in contact with them, naturally you can bring the pathogen to the human. That we call it zoonosis. And the pathogen can be transmitted to humans. This before we go further, so that we talk about the same subject. Zoonosis means that those diseases and infection that are naturally transmitted between vertebrate animals and men with or without arthropod immediate. Meaning that dengue, is it zoonosis or not? How you got dengue? Yeah. Mosquito bite. You think it's a zoonosis? I think Prof is right. Initially, we call symbiotic dengue. Now we have urban dengue, where there are long-term markup as part of the reservoir, normally in the fringe of jungles. So now dengue got nothing to do with the animal. Although the transmission via arthropod, but it's not there's no reservoir of urban dengue in the animal, so not considered as zoonosis. About malaria? Yeah, the traditional malaria that you're talking about is not zoonosis, but nonosis, yes, we have low-tank markup as a reservoir. I think that's the issue being brought up just now. I think nonosis, as far as Malaysia is concerned, a lot of work being done by Prof. Balbesin from University of Malaysia, Sarawak, in Limas. I think you can look at that. Yeah.
Plasmodium was
back in. Yeah, you are right.
Was a primary mosquito cycle, yeah. Or maybe even a bird mosquito cycle.
Yeah, it's always there. But in terms of developments of PCR methods to diagnose, because otherwise, for your information, when they look back at those who are having Plasmodium malariae, they look back at the slide and then they do PCR later on when the PCR only developed method. It turned out to be it's not malaria. It will be all the while is a nolosai. And nolosai is more virulent than traditional malaria. And in the Ministry of Health, we have a standing order. Those who are diagnosed with nolosai need to send for PCR. Because we need to, if it turned out to be PCR, we need more aggressive treatments. Because their mortality, the fatality rate is higher compared to the national malaria. And up to now, we have thousands of E. dolosai. That worries us now. Because very difficult, because long-term makak is almost everywhere. And when we contact through our One Health initiative, our wildlife department, nothing to do with DBS, they do catch this long-term makak. But whether they may be killed some because of, for ethical reason. They try to depopulate the long-term makak to other areas deep in the jungle. But you know very well that some people go to the jungle for whatever reasons, like hunting, so hitchhiking or extreme sports, isn't it? So they come in contact.
And
yeah, that's right. You got a long memory. And on top of that, the development that come to the shore of the jungle, fringe of the jungle, that expose the interface between the human and the long-term makak. So I think this already stated many times that this important zoonotic because prior to my appointment as director of National Public Laboratory, I was heading a zoonosis sector in Ministry of Health. So zoonosis sector came into being in 2010 because we feel that zoonosis is a neglected disease. And if you look at the current new novel pathogen that circulating that occur, they say last 10 years, can you name a few? Example? Muscovy, it thought to be the fruit bats or camels, isn't it? Ebola, it could be non-human primates. SARS, is a civet. Yeah, Hendra from the fruit bats. Nipah. So almost all you can mention is about the zoonosis. I think that's why zoonosis now become important. So, and then zoonosis is not like just non-communicable disease that diabetes doctor can treat on their own. You need to work with other agencies. That how One Health is come into being and is now become a very important part even university curriculum, the module that they want to develop. So these are the recap. I think all of you know how the disease from the animals. If I don't use this one, is it okay? Or I need to use this one, okay. I thought my voice is not enough. Okay, these are the mode of transmission from the animals. Essentially, zoonosis is the animal disease that transmits to the human. How do you go to about? First is through the direct contacts. Direct contacts. This, I think for the bat, look familiar with the reddish of the this one. And then the feet. It's avian influenza. It's avian influenza. Come in contact or rats. Rat can even scratch, the rat scratch fever or top. On top of that, we have other diseases that carry by rats, like leptospirosis,
antivirus,
yeah, right. So, some other direct contact or it goes to the environment first, like water. When the rat contaminate water or the air, like in wet market in China, that's how they spread the avian influenza actually. They when they investigate at the farm, they don't find H7N9 in the farm. But when the samples the wet market in the cities, it turned out to be presence of avian influenza. Because over there, I think partly in Malaysia also, people like chicken. So they keep a live chicken, but not only chicken they keep in the wet market and then live animal market. Also other exotic animals. Seabeds, things like that. And then their open market, they've got interaction with wild birds. So how they interact. So the wild market, the wet market is the source of infection for avian influenza in China. And then through the products, eggs, meat, milk. Can you give examples, say from the eggs, what are the zoonotic diseases that you can think of? Salmonellosis, isn't it? Very common. What the milk?
Brucellosis.
Brucella. These are due to the reason that in Malaysia we allow actually to send raw goat's milk, not fresh. When talking, you have to differentiate between fresh and raw goat's milk. I prefer fresh because fresh is really pasteurized. Raw means that there's nothing done, there's no process done. Fresh from the other this one animal go to you. So if the animal is healthy, if you can maintain a healthy population of animal, no problem. Like I think in UK, in certain part of Europe also, they allow to sell a raw milk from the animal, from the cows. But I think France, they got different different laws. Huh?
Not cattle, so it's not allowed in Europe. Cows milk, but goat milk in some places.
Yeah. Okay. So that's a problem. So I think we can discuss it. We have some initiative that before I left the zoonotic sector, we have several initiative that we did how to overcome the brucellosis in Malaysia. And then from the meat examples, sarcocystis. Are you from Pahang? Sorry? Because we have several outbreak of sarcocystis. Sarcocystis in the European tours that come to our resort, Tioman Island, we have I think 2-3 outbreaks of sarcocystis. Sarcocystis. Yeah, you are right. Because they butcher the animals without proper PPEs. We don't have anthrax in Malaysia at the moment. And then through the arthropod, I think you know, like example, Japanese encephalitis, West Nile. Okay. These are the ways and means. These are important because we know you have to know how they spread and in order for you to control. Of course, control is not always easy, but if you don't know how it spread, then how are you going to do the controls? Like sarcocystis, we may not find the host, but we know how it spread, then we can do the controls by proper cooking, things like that. What a raw meat or raw. Some people like it raw, isn't it? I prefer to be well done. Okay, these are the agents, bacteria, viruses. I don't want to go to details. These are basic textbook stuff. Rickettsia, fungus, protozoa. Now, by the way, fungus. Recently, if somebody from Johor, I think you are aware that dermatologists see quite a number of cases of sporotrichosis due to the spread of fungus. And then some are very bad. It goes into septic. It goes into the blood, cause blood poisoning, and need to be treated with amphotericin B drips. So quite bad. This is sporotrichosis. I think also toxoplasmosis. You are aware that talking about in Malaysia, every pregnant lady we do a torches. T stand for toxoplasma. We're looking for this one. These are spectrums. Spectrum of zoonosis. You can start with asymptomatic leptospirosis. Majority of cases, let's say 100 students goes to the swimming in the river, in the freshwater ponds, not all come up with leptospirosis. Some may have got the germs enter into the body, but they don't display any symptoms. Some just a mild symptom, ILI, influenza like illness. Some are bad. Some even worse, develop complication like pulmonary hemorrhage, things like that, and die. So it got a spectrum of disease. Rabies. Interesting about rabies. Somebody told asked me how to diagnose rabies. He said, "How to diagnose rabies? Do you have any idea?"
Cut out their head.
Because if you don't know the pathogenesis of rabies, then you ask a silly question from laboratory. They ask us to do a serology for rabies. You know that rabies actually enter the body and it goes straight to the initially of course in the blood, and then it goes straight to the nerve, and then it travels from that. I said it normally get bitten at the legs, it travels to the spinal cord and then end up in the brain, and then it goes to salivary gland, it comes out. So you ask, you send a serum to me, nothing much I can do from the laboratory. So I said, you must know your pathogen, or you discuss yourself what specimen you want to send. I advise to send for saliva. Of course, you cannot cut the human head. You can take a biopsy, a knuckle line, where they got. But mind you, you need to take the hair follicle as well, because hair follicle contain the nerve ending. That's how we diagnose rabies. So if you send a wrong specimen, sorry, you cannot do.
How about CSF?
CSF, yeah, but less. Yeah, because the positivity rate is not that much. But yes, CSF. Saliva, biopsy, and a knuckle line, but don't send serums. Okay. These are the impact. I think the problem with zoonosis is not all notifiable. Even in the developed country, not all zoonotic diseases are notifiable. So in Malaysia, leptospirosis only made notifiable after the incident. You remember Lubuk U incident? That 7 died. We published a paper on that. Then we become notifiable. Prior to that, it's not notifiable. Even brucellosis is not notifiable. But after the outbreak in Penang, I think Dr. Vena will talk to you on tomorrow. We have a big outbreak of brucellosis in Penang. We make it notifiable by administrative, not yet by law. But leptospirosis already by law, signed by minister. So actually the burden of the disease, we do not know for sure. Okay, these are the burden. And then why zoonosis is a neglected disease? Because we normally feel that the control of zoonotic disease is not live with us, isn't it? Medical doctor, because we work in the hospital or in clinics. So this the territory of veterinarian or wildlife or others, we call it others. But mind you, in order for them to work, they need our inputs. So we need their inputs. That is rabies. If you don't notify them, how on the earth, unless you do a surveillance lah, they just take certain numbers of dogs. Otherwise, they will know. The one that case that implies, if we don't notify them, we don't know that 30% of our dogs are rabies positive, isn't it? We are happily say that we are rabies free country, and then we minimize our stockpile, our vaccine stockpile. Now we build up again lah. Last time we used to very minimal rabies stockpile vaccine, and also immunoglobulin prior to the incident in police, very limited. In the big cities only immunoglobulin is available. Now we already imported. Immunoglobulin is not registered in the blue book, meaning that you cannot buy. Even a private hospital cannot buy the immunoglobulin. You need a special permission from our Director General of Medical Services, because it's not listed in Malaysia to that extent. Because we feel we are quite happy we are free from rabies. Being taught that rabies is, zoonotic, it affects the poor section of the community. But it's not true. If during my time in the Ministry of Health, we have students from Damansara, by the way, is so-called middle or upper class people. Their son, their daughter got the disease. You know why? Because they live in a very clean environment, but they go to picnic. They are exposed, so it's not true. Zoonotic can affect other people as well. And with today's our activities, we have one, very in thing now to talk about, is ecotourism, isn't it? Where we go to the jungle, this one, we are exposed. In fact, Malaysia is famous for, during the fourth rally challenge in Sabah, in Borneo Sabah, where they drove a four-wheel drive, swims, and go hike in the mountain, things like that. And then I think, I don't have the slide here, I think around 200 something, but fortunately there's no death during that episode. And difficulty in diagnosis, because if you don't, they got variety of disease, we don't have all the protocol in the laboratory in what I call it, prepared. So we have to think forward. I will tell you how we, in the National Public Health Laboratory, how we prepare ourselves to foresee that future problems. And also, there's no specific symptoms. Leptospirosis, during my student days, two things I remember about leptospirosis during my medical student days. One is golden jaundice. Remember? I don't know whether they taught you about that. Golden jaundice. Golden jaundice is hardly seen nowadays because the pathogenesis may be different. And then they said it's a great mimicker. A great mimicker is true till now. It can be confused for dengue, for typhoid, for malaria. So you need to have a good clinical acumen. The thing is that you need the exposure history. If you don't have exposure history, they will lead to extreme. So I will emphasize one or two slides on exposure history, because these are my themes of whenever I give talk. If the doctor don't ask the exposure history, most probably you miss zoonotic diseases. And symptom sign may similar be other diseases. These are the examples. And also nowadays become important because of can be used for bioterrorism. I think that part why like our company here being funded by USAID because US are very afraid of they thought that our region epicenter for future outbreak of this one and also possible of bioterrorism. But they are wrong. You see, during the previous, I think the last 10 years, they thought that avian influenza, influenza pandemic influenza, we start from Southeast Asia or Asia Pacific region. But it start from where? Veracruz, Mexico, their neighbors, isn't it? H1N1 pandemic influenza. They are wrong. In fact, the first H1N1 novavirus was found in California, not Veracruz. They already found in the animal. At that time, American system so good, they not spread to the human. But in Mexico, in the peak, and it spread to the human, and then acquire a human, genetic material, it become efficient to human to human. So the Mexico got blamed, not America. Sorry. Okay, that's good. Okay, I think you already mentioned about this. Okay, just talking about emerging and re-emerging, because people sometimes use interchangeably. Emerging refer to the newly recognized or newly evolved. Prostan mentioned just now, the neurosite may be all around, in the wildlife, but nobody detects. So merely recognized, we call it merely recognized, emerging. And also re-emerging meaning that it's already there, become spread to the new populations or new geographical area or become in terms of numbers. Like now TB in Malaysia, we call it re-emerging because we have a lot of problem. What about Ebola? Is it emerging or re-emerging? Yeah, re-emerging. Ebola actually, all the while, in the populations of the non-human primates, and it occurred in Sudan, Zaire, but now in West Africa, Guinea, Sierra Leone, and one more is what? Liberia. Prior to this, there's no Ebola at that particular area, West Africa. It got nothing to do with Ebola, but it spread to new geographical areas, we call it re-emerging. I want to ask you a question, because I attend one of the lectures, they said, somebody told the audience that this is why so many deaths in West Africa? Is it a virulent Ebola? What do you think? Is it more virulent? So why it caused so many deaths, so much problem? WHO also got problem to control the disease as compared to in Sudan, in Zaire. Yeah, different culture. West African, some we call it bush meat. In Zaire also eat bush meat, in West Africa also eat bush meat. No much different in terms of culture. Yes, partly. What do you think?
Population density.
Yeah, you are right, Prof. Because in Zaire and Sudan, it occurs in small village, you know. So when you look at the history of Ebola, whenever they occur, they condemn the whole village. So they make sure that they won't spread. But in Liberia, it occurred in the middle of towns, you know, people moving very fast. So that's why they got problems controlling. In terms of virulency, when they do the food genotyping, it's not more virulent than the previous outbreaks. And of course, the health system, because these are poor country, they're not capable to cope with this one. Of course, that lot because they're not aware, they don't have facility initially to diagnose. On top of the general population, the health staff also. Sorry, I don't use my. The health staff, I got excited sometimes. The health staff also. I think about 30% of the health staff being affected. You know, so it collapsed the health system. That's what they need. In fact, we send. I think from EIP, we send our staff also to help them. Not that much, not that many, because we don't have that many experts to spare. So we did actually help them, and also we send some PPEs now. To West Africa countries.
Can I add to the Prof's discussion that do you think Ebola has gone now? They say there's no more cases of Ebola.
Eliminated? No,
it's around.
So yeah.
It can happen again.
Yeah, that's right.
Same with SARS. It's not gone.
Very true. Then another question, since you're talking about Ebola, you accept me. Do you think that Ebola presence in our region, Southeast Asia? Possible, yes. In fact, one of the projects that National Public Laboratory will conduct next year, 2016, we have become a virus hunter. We are looking for actually novel viruses in our jungles with two NGOs from America, actually quite good in terms of funding. There are two NGOs from America, Eco Health Alliance, and also GVFI, Global Viral Forecasting Initiative. We will sign MOU, they will fund us.
It's our sister project.
Oh, okay.
Funded by USAID, it's called PREDICT.
Yeah, you're right.
In Sabah.
Yeah. No, in Sabah they got a project, but now we're going to penetrate in Peninsula Malaysia. Three areas have been selected. One is Gua Musang, second one in Kuala Lipis, Pahang, third one in Kuala Kangsar, in the Orang Asli settlement, in our Aborigines. So we are taking the blood from the Aborigines and also from the wildlife. That's why this is how One Health works. We need a wildlife department to catch hold of green long-tailed macaque and wild boar, things like that. And then we send the animal sample to VRI, and the human sample we send to us. We will do the screening. Yeah, that's right. These are the I think this being shown different maps. The dark blue is a new one, X79. We have experienced this in 2014. We have experienced handle this. We have experienced handle this. We have laboratory capacity. For those who doesn't know, I'll give you examples. 3 weeks ago, a West African, I mean, recently in Malaysia, but he went back to his own native country. Fall sick, of course, these are quite rich person, ended in Peace Court, one of the good private hospitals in Kuala Lumpur. So, when they said, I'm from Guinea, I got high fever, everybody got scared. So they sent to our Ministry of Health Infectious Ward, Infectious Hospital, in Sungai Buloh, which is my neighbor lah. Hospital is one entity, laboratory is another entity, but neighbors lah. So they sent to Dr. Of course, take charge of Dr. Christopher Lee, our top ID physician. So they contact us. I think late evening they contact us to say that we have suspected, we call it PY, person under investigation for Ebola. And we have our protocol ready for Ebola. Not all hospitals, even Sungai Buloh infectious, this hospital cannot do Ebola. But we in the public health authority, we are prepared for that. We will develop the protocol for Ebola. So they sent to us at 1 a.m. early in the morning. So we make our lab open. So we receive a sample at 11 a.m. We give the result. It turned out, we are lucky it turned out to be negative, but it turned out to be what? Do you have any idea? Malaria. Yes, malaria.
No, no, Lisi lah.
No. It's a Ovali.
Ovali.
So the lesson learned here, of course, when they thought it's Ebola, all have been hyped up. They got into push into isolation. Their PPEs, all this one has been double up. You know, when we told them, oh, no, malaria is 40, Ebola negative, then they stand down. In terms of course, malaria you need some precaution, but not as high as Ebola. So that's how very important. If you suspect something that something fishy going on, or you suspect something, please contact us. We are public health authority, so we are looking at the big picture. Even private hospital, if they think that they cannot do, we will accept, because we think a big picture. Because if they spread the Ebola to the community, then Malaysia have a lot of money, rather than we spend say a few hundred testing for Ebola for the private patients, isn't it? We don't get anything, but we know that we can contain the disease. Yeah. So this is our Malaysian scenario. Malaysia boleh, Malaysia can, our share of new viruses. So these are brand new viruses that we found in Malaysia territory. So looking at the world this one, viruses, you see, this one 1999, we have Nipah virus. Nipah, by the way, is a name of village in somewhere in Negeri Sembilan lah, Bukit Pelanduk.
Sungai Nipah.
Sungai Nipah, you are right, doctor. So, our contribution to the world, actually. But of course, we need the CDC. Yeah, because they think that this new discovery only done by Western world, not necessary. We, of course, we the help of the CDC at Atlanta lah. We have the specimen, our doctors went there, and then do the same, do concurrently with CDC guys. We found the virus. Otherwise, you know what we treat as when Nipah outbreak, I was a district health officer somewhere in Johor Bahru. So we stopped millions of JE vaccine. We thought initially as JE.
Yeah.
But after the vaccine, still people come down in Nipah with this one, which is a direct contact. And I want to highlight one of the viruses that this one, Melaka virus. These are the state now we are in is Melaka. For Chua Kau Beng, the previous our biologist in National Public Laboratory discovered this virus in 2007. And he got scolded by Chief Minister of Malacca because they said this bring a bad name to the state of Malacca. But they don't know, the naming of the virus depends on the place where they found the virus. So this is our contribution, Kapa virus. And now Pulau virus, we still what I call it, passage this virus in our laboratory. So now they got interest in doing some research. Because at that time when we discovered about 10 years ago, we don't have much use of this virus, but we maintain the virus so that, you know, for what? For future diagnostic kits and also probably candidate for vaccine developments in the future. These are the examples of emerging. I don't think I should go into details of this thing. Monkeypox. BSE.
Yeah.
BSE, you know, it start from Europe actually because their feet, they grind the diseased animal. Part of their feet is not only grass but the carcass, isn't it? Some are sick animal, so that how they spread. And then it spread to the human. In human, you call it VCJD, you know, variant preferred Jacob disease. Through the prions, actually through the proteins.
They make cows into cannibals.
Yeah. And Nipah, I think I don't need to go into details. I think everybody already talked about Nipah. Just want to highlight a few things. Like Prof said just now, Nipah could be circulating in our fruit bags, but it don't go to the human. You know why? Actually, what triggers the this one? That outbreaks of Nipah in a human, you have any idea? Sorry, doctor.
Deforestation
development. It could be, but in this particular outbreak, it's not due to the deforestation. Yeah, you are right. Because in Tambo Nipo, I think Dr. Zakaria just mentioned that in Tambo, that particular pig farm, they got a fruit orchard over there. So half eaten fruits fall into the pig pens. The pig seed, pig is not a reservoir for Nipah. Pig got seed. And that particular pig pens holding maybe hundreds or thousands of pigs, and it got spread. Because I saw the video of pig getting Nipah, it's very terrible. Although it's a pig is pig,
yeah.
But we feel pity over the pig also. It really, they cough and then they fall down, you know, with this one's oozing from the nose and things like that. Very terrible to the pig. And for them to cut the losses, they got a fire sale. So they spread to the Bukit Pelanduk. Bukit Pelanduk, by the way, before the outbreak, is the biggest. Malaysia is a Muslim country, but we are the biggest exporter of pork. We used to. So the center is Bukit Pelanduk. Bukit Pelanduk is...
Before Bukit Pelanduk was Sikamat.
Ah, Sikamat. It's nearby area.
Nearby my school.
So we lost about 1 million pig because we kill. We cull a pig. And then almost devastating the industry. Now we slowly develop against but of course we proper... And then I ask the same question. Do you think that Nipah is now no longer in Malaysia?
Circulating.
Yeah, circulating. In our fruit bags, I think one of the speaker mentioned about we are lucky because our bats, fruit bats, not vampire bats, they don't go and bite people. Yeah, Bangladesh because they got different way of transmission. because that dates, you know, suck, set from the dates. We use a earthen jar, then this particular bat also sip the sap of the food date. Then we contaminated that.
It's like the way we do our gula nira, our tuak.
Yeah. And on top of that, the sana ofu, the whole half-eaten fruits, dates, also been picked up by the children. Yeah. They got the disease. So Bangladesh and eastern part of India, I think the worst scenario is Bangladesh. But in Malaysia, when they study the Therapus vampirus, the fruit bats that circulating in Malaysia, it still contain Nipah. But we don't get it. You know what? Because after the Nipah outbreak, the DVS, Veterinary Services, make a regulation that all pig farms must be have a buffer zone about 100 meters from the orchard. So there's no, what I call it, interaction, interface between these two. And of course, they go the modern pig farming industry later on.
Some Nipah
impacts in Thailand
too,
yeah.
But they have no
big farm there. Yeah. Nipah don't stay in Malaysia. In fact, the same fruit bat goes to Thailand, goes to Indonesia.
Migrate.
I tell you that last year in Philippines, when I attended one of the WHO meetings in the Philippines, they told us that they got one mysterious disease in southern part of the Philippines. For 1 month, they are grappling. What disease is that? People dying of the disease. And later on, it turned out to be what? Nipah. Because I don't blame them, because they don't have the facility. Because ours, we had a facility how to diagnose Nipah. Because we have gone through the lesson learned previously. So they had to send to Australia. I can't remember the lab.
Geelong,
yeah, you're right. So they take 1 month to diagnose Nipah. Mysterious disease turned out to be Nipah. So we have to be vigilant. That's why in Malaysia, when I was in the Ministry of Health, we used to receive a specimen. Those encephalitic patients, Nipah cause brain inflammation. So apart from screening for JE, for whatever, you know, we also run for Nipah as well. So monthly I receive a returns from Institute of Medical Research that we have screened so many of encephalitic patients, so far Nipah free. I'm very interested because once I got the positive, I'm very worried. Because Nipah, you know, is spread by contact. You don't need a fruit bat anymore. Once you got Nipah, you can spread by contact. Even medical, personal, don't take proper PPE, you can got it. Yeah. So this is our Nipah experience. And then SARS, I think SARS, by the way, is similar in terms of same family virus with the MERS-CoV, coronavirus. So we have a very bad experience of SARS, but in terms of tourism being affected, people spread to come to Southeast Asia because they thought it's epicenter. I was in District Health Officer of Johor Bahru at that time. During SARS, we have to work 24 hours actually. We have to shift. Because if you know Johor Bahru, we have a causeway that linked to the Singapore. And Singapore at that time very badly affected because it started with Mong Kok Hotel in Hong Kong from the Guangzhou, isn't it? They stay in the Mong Kok Hotel and few doctors or what stay in Mong Kok Hotel in Hong Kong. It brought SARS to the Singapore at that time. Nobody know about SARS, so even health staff also get affected. So we have to screen people 24 hours a day for those. Because in Johor and Singapore, about 100,000 people move in and out because our economy is interlinked. So we are lucky at that time. We don't have confirmed SARS, but our tourism being badly affected in SARS. We are lucky because at that time, by the time people, we take precaution because we know that they need droplets spreads. We already take a negative pressure, those are affected, so we are lucky. We don't have confirmed case. I think person are negative for SARS. And then it's highly pathogenic avian influenza, H5N1. This one also a record for Ministry of Health. I think we have to, some people when they give talk about H5N1, they talk about cases in Malaysia. They think that human population also got H5N1. So far we are lucky. The H5N1 that we had in 2004 till been declared by OIE in 2007, all confined to our poultry. There's no single case of human case of H5N1 in Malaysia. That's we are lucky. How you do it? We work very closely with our DBS. DBS, whenever they got this suspected case of H5N1, the condon area, of course they do the stamping, calm down. And we do the active case detection. Those who are having flu, we check. We quickly isolate and check, isolate and check. So we are lucky. DBS do so efficient, their work, they have not spread to the human. So so far, I think they maintain. DBS still maintain a certain well-located sample. They take domestic bird, domestic poultry. Then also, they also collaborate with our wildlife, look for migratory birds. So far, the report that I have, they said we are free from H5N1. So we should maintain that way. And then, because our neighbors are not free, our Indonesians, this one. And mind you that the 2004 outbreak in somewhere in Kelantan, when we do, now we can do fingerprinting actually, we can do genotyping. We can know whether this particular virus, actually, they are where their grandparents. So we look at their details, actually come from Thailand, sorry. And then the last case, 2007, these are due to the fighting cocks. You know that very price, they are smuggles. Huh? They smuggle their, this, what we call it, very precise cocks for fighting. It costs thousands or hundreds of ringgits. Huh? So when we want to cull also got problem, because we give a few, say 20 ringgits or what, but it costs hundreds. Huh? So they used to run away with their cocks. And the last case 2007 in Pulau Payah Jaras in Selangor is actually related to Indonesia, because some Indonesian brought their fighting cocks to that particular area. So from then on, 2007, we are free from H5N1. We work very closely with DBS. Of course, they do the culling. Yeah? And then come pandemic H1N1, 2009. Now, this one they thought that we will be exposed somewhere. We start with Southeast Asia or Asia Pacific region, but somehow it start in Mexico. By this time, we are lucky because after the SARS outbreak, we developed what we call it national NIPP, National Influenza Pandemic Preparedness Plan, NIPP, 2006, come into being, very thick books, how to handle pandemic spread. So by the time we part H1N1 pandemic, we already have in place the strategy. So we work quite well. Nevertheless, we are quite badly affected by the H1N1 because they spread very, very fast. Spanish flu 1918, it takes months, 6 months to spread to the other part of the world. But in H1N1, within months, I think 1 month after the outbreak in Mexico, we already got first case in Malaysia. It's a Malaysian, Malaysian who stayed in America, but came back to Malaysia to visit relative, it turned out to be positive. So from there on, of course, initially we try to contain lah. We have two strategies, containment and mitigations. We try to, during the containment, we are very strict. If we know that a person having H1N1, we will catch all of him or her and then put them in the isolation room. All the contact will be strict. Even 2 o'clock in the morning, we knock the door, ask the contact to come over to the hospital. We are very strict because we want to contain. But unfortunately, we're not able to contain spread very fast because these are novel viruses. By the way, H1N1 is not new. Spanish flu outbreak in 1918 also H1N1. But they are different novel viruses because they already incorporated the pig influenza vaccine, the wild duck, and also human. That's why they become a very efficient H2H spreads. Huh? So now H1N1, if you think that H1N1 is over from Malaysia, so part of our screening, when the people from Hajj, coming back from Hajj, when we suspect Muscovy, mostly turned out to be H1N1. But we not to worry because H1N1 is now become a seasonal influenza. In fact, if you look at our trivalent vaccine, it contains what? Influenza. You know what our influenza vaccine contains? 2 A by A influenza, 1 is B influenza. H3N2 and 1 is pandemic strain, H1N1, and another one is B influenza, either Yamagata or this one, another one. So now it becomes, the thing is that about the virus, after a while, it loses its virulency because so many people already exposed, so it loses its virulency and then no much a problem. Of course, those who are having comorbidity still got problems, because badly affected by this too. Okay, now H7 and 9. Also, avian influenza. What is the main difference between H7 and 9 and H5N1? Do you have any idea? Vet? Any vet? What do you think? No, yeah. H7 and 9 and H5N1 are avian influenza. What is the difference between H7 and 9 and H5N1? Of course, you look at the genetic material, of course, different.
H7N9 doesn't cause disease.
Yes, that's a problem start. Because H5N1, when it goes into the poultry, the poultry becomes sick. So they know that it's spreading their disease. But H7N9, the poultry, we call it low pathogenic avian influenza. The poultry is still running about. But in human, it becomes very bad. So we have some problem if there is outbreak. As compared to H5N1, just now I mentioned that we will manage to stamp out if this particular virus spread to our poultry. I don't know what's going to happen. We have some big problems. But we are lucky till now. I will talk more about H7 and 9 in terms of genetic material. You look here. One thing about influenza, by the way, influenza, they got influenza A, B and C. Only A being shared by human and animals. There's no B influenza in the animals. Also, C influenza is very mild. So we don't bother. That's why in our vaccine candidate also, we don't have a C influenza. And one thing about influenza is unpredictability. They call it antigenic shift and antigenic drift. Have you heard about that? After a while, initially it drifts. And then when it shifts, it becomes a novel viruses, brand new viruses. What they did, actually, they tried to incorporate the genetic materials. Influenza is 8 chromosome RNAs, and being characterized by heme agglutinin and neuraminidase, and also their chromosome. So every time influenza replicates, they try, of course, RNA, you have to become DNA, and then you have to this one. So they try to incorporate other genetic materials. So what happened in H7N9, they take the hemagglutinin from the domestic duck, H7N3, and neuraminidase also the envelope proteins, from the wild bird, H7N9, and their chromosome from Bremen birds, you see. So it become a re-assortant virus, a new viruses, brand new viruses. But we are lucky, they are not incorporating the human influenza virus genetic material. In H1N1, they got quadruple reassortment, where they got pigs, ducks, wild birds, and also human. But H7N9, we are lucky, they still maintain the avian influenza as such. So there's no, efficient human-to-human transmission of the avian influenza. Okay, talking about H7 and 9, I think this morning somebody talked about vaccinations, isn't it? So, Ministry of Health used to give vaccination to the frontliners for influenza. Do you think that the vaccination that we gave will protect us from getting avian influenza?
Not really.
Certain period of time. What do you think?
Because the, as you mentioned about the drift and the shift, is as long as it is drifting, we are sort of partially protected. But the minute the whole thing change to become a novel virus.
Okay. To start with, the vaccine that we gave to our frontliner is not avian influenza.
Ah, lagi teruk.
It's a seasonal trivalent influenza flu vaccine. H3N2, pandemic strain H1N1 dengan B influenza. in nothing to do with the avian influenza. We don't give. In fact, in Singapore, a rich country, small country but very rich. So they stockpile avian influenza. They got H5N1 vaccine, 1 million dose, but lock and barrel. They don't allow anybody get hold of that particular vaccine. Only used for when there is outbreak, and they're thinking of cross protection when there is, because the strain that you use is previous strain. So they are hoping for some form cross protection. But we still give the frontliner our seasonal influenza. You know for what reason? Not to protect against this one. For what reason it is? Why we spend money? You have any idea?
Nak kasi orang kaya.
Oh. So the first thing they said is to prevent the background noise. You know.
Okay.
You know what I mean by that?
Yes.
If a person got say influenza, and then on top of that, our frontliner mean that they go to the community. They may expose to the infected chicken, H7N9. So that particular virus, avian influenza, may go into the human. So they may have reassortment of the virus in the human. So we want to prevent the human flu to be taken off. If the person got it, there's no resettlement with the human flu. That for first reason. To prevent reassortment of the avian influenza virus. That's first reason. Second reason? So that our staff are healthy. Because if at that particular time when it's outbreak of avian influenza, then they got fall sick with a common influenza, that's very bad, isn't it? So we protect them for frontliners. And on top of that, is for epidemiology purposes. If a person already vaccinated against seasonal influenza falls sick during their field work, handling a chicken, then we have to think highly of avian influenza. Unlikely due to the human influenza, because already vaccinated them, isn't it? So for that reason, we still do the vaccinations. I think China still have a problem with avian influenza H7N9. It becomes seasonal, no? It's not always there. But okay, we have experience how to handle H7N9. Eh? This particular person, a female tourist from Guangdong, China, 67 years old. Actually, she already fell sick in China on 30th January 2014. But she went to a GP, general practitioner over there. But surprisingly, even in China, people not aware of what, some GPs, some general practitioners not fully aware about this particular disease. They thought just an ordinary influenza. They treat the patient, and the patient traveled to Malaysia, landed in Malaysia in, I think, 4th of February. Last year, he landed in Kuala Lumpur. He goes to the East Coast, East Malaysia, to the Sabah, and goes to Sandakan. And by the time on the 7th of February last year, she already got very severe disease, admitted to the hospital. And we are lucky because that particular hospital, just conducted a field simulation avian influenza exercise. So they say, oh, you are a tourist from China, you got this symptom of pneumonia and flu, you should check for avian influenza. So they quickly sent to us. So of course, we are already prepared for H7N9. Of course, they cannot do it. They sent to us. They have flown the sample to Kuala Lumpur and also to Sungai Buloh, split two of the samples. Huh? By the way, we have a research laboratory and also public health laboratory. They conducted this so-called exotic testing. So we conducted the test and it confirmed by real-time polymerase chain reaction, RT-PCR. First we do the screening, looking for upstream gene envelopes, UPE, and then we confirm by open reading frames, ORF. So both testing are positive, so we have confirmed this H7N9. Of course, after the confirmation, we do the full genome sequencing. we did a full genome sequencing, genotypic sequencing, and then we can prove conclusively that this particular virus originate from China. When we look at the phylogenetic analysis, when we look at the phylogenetic analysis of this particular patient, their hemoglobin is very closely related to Guangzhou, and neuraminidase very closely related to Guangdong strains. So we know that these are imported strains. On top of that, from our DPS surveillance, we don't have X7N9 in our poultry as well as in our wild bird. So we prove that these are imported cases. And mind you that, although we know that X7N9 is not efficient in terms of H2H, human to human, but nevertheless, we, what I call it, not quarantine, we monitor about 400 contacts, including the doctors, the airline crews that when patient comes in, those their tour groups contact. I think she has two sons accompany her, so we are lucky actually. All contacts, some come down with the flu, but it turned out to be a normal flu. It's not 7 and 9. Even their son, I mean her son, two sons that accompany her, does not have avian influenza because it's not efficient yet in terms of human to human spread. Yeah. Then what? What the hell? How she got it, isn't it? Do you have any idea how she got it? Yeah? Any guess? Guess teammate?
She keep fighting cop?
No. These are old lady. You know? She's not interested in cop anymore, any fighting cops anymore. Yeah. No, backyard chicken. Before, I think 1 or 2 days, I think on the 27th, if not mistaken, 1 or 2 days before, she fall sick, she bought a live chicken. I told you that over there people like to have live chicken. And then some of them, not all Chinese, nah, they use their blood in their cooking, isn't it? Sorry, I mean not all, but some. So she bought a live chicken, she slaughtered in the house. Of course, when she slaughtered, I told you that chicken look healthy, H7N9, not H5N1, look healthy. And she got it because she exposed herself. But the son eat the chicken, but already cooked. So, okay, no problems. Eh? They're very sad. The mother has got it because I mentioned to you just now that the chicken looked healthy to her. And then, so these are success stories. We managed to treat the patient well, discharge well, and we send back the patient to China. You know, when we went to send back the patient to China, the airline refused to take her because when we know that H7N9, we ask the airline crew who are come in contact with this particular patient, we not to say quarantine, but we ask them not to work for 10 days. Wow. You are under observation. Yeah. So they lose money. So they said, no, I don't want to take her anymore. We said, no, this patient is really well, discharged well. The sputum, the aspirate, all negative. So in order for her to give that some confidence to the airline, one of the doctors had to accompany her to Shenzhen in Hong Kong and then take a ferry to Guangdong. Of course, she's rich, she can pay the doctor get a good trip, free trips. Okay, the Muscovy. We have one case of Muscovy in April 2014. So, you see, but we are in Malaysia, we are quite lucky. Before the disease came, we already prepared the protocols. The whatever protocol that we think that is necessary, we prepared. Nowadays, we are getting one step ahead. Let's say you have a dengue case. We have thousands of dengue in Malaysia. Quite bad the situation of dengue. So we're looking for, of course, the normal dengue 1, dengue 2, dengue 3, dengue 4. Then we are not happy. These are the black malaria. These are the traditional serotype of dengue, but we are thinking of different serotype of dengue. Maybe dengue, or it could be Zika. Have you heard about Zika? Zika is a flaviviridae. It's same family with dengue. So we developed a family protocol. Our PCR, our polymerization reaction protocol, is not specific. We learn predict protocol. We run this protocol, flaviviridae protocol, for 51 species, including a Wasna, Zika. So whenever we got positive, we will do the electrophoresis and do the gene sequencing. Of course, we can know the details of it. That's one thing. So we one step ahead. We're looking for normal viruses because not all within one. We cannot afford to have each and every one protocol for that. Viruses not existed in Malaysia, isn't it? So we have run a flavi very day family protocols. Of course, thanks to Predix. And then on top of that, we are one step ahead now. When we receive the samples for genotyping, dengue we do a serotyping and genotyping. Of course, serotyping can give to gen 1, gen 2, gen 3, gen 4 lah, because that's a serological. And then we do a genotyping. We run for flavi every day. I'm talking about IMR. I'm talking about National Public Laboratory. This not done in the university or hospitals. These are our laboratory. We split the specimen into two. Another half portion of specimen we run BI. We do a virological isolation. You know why? Because protocol only good if you already develop the protocol, isn't it? We know the viruses. If I know viruses, we don't have protocols. So how are we going to know it? By virus isolation. If we find something growing, not detected by our protocol, then we do. Of course, in our public health laboratory, we have electron microscope transmission, and so we have no problems. We can do a sequencing. So we try to look for novel viruses. So MERS-CoV, yes, we have this particular person came back from a small hut, or Umrah we call it. By the way, we are exposed to MERS-CoV because every year about 20 to 30,000 nation Muslim goes to the Saudi Arabia performing Hajj in Mecca and Medina. And on top of that, we have a small Hajj, Umrah we call it, about 200,000 per year. So we are constantly exposed to the MERS-CoV. We have to be on vigilant actually. So if you come back from Hajj or Umrah, they will screen you at the airport. They are screening you at the airport. And this particular person, oh okay, I have to stop. okay.
Protect.
Sorry?
Abang
kan cerita ni. Okay, this particular person, MERS-CoV, how actually they got it? This particular person, we already informed the tour package agency that don't bring to the camel farm. You know, in fact, when I went to perform my umrah, so they brought me to camel farm. Actually, it's one of the itinerary lah. And then they offer you a raw camel mix, ask you to drink. I refuse because I look the other of the camel so dirty. I said no, thank you. But this person drank the raw camel mix. On top of that, they pat the face of that camel and then they rub their face. I don't know for whatever reasons, and then maybe the reasons. And that particular person come back with a MERS-CoV.
Baik. Apa tak sebaik?
Okay, I think you know what we mentioned just now. Okay. These are the patterns. I think we already touched during the previous lecture on climate change. You know that climate change, mosquito can breed faster during the hotter environments. Dengue become a problem. And the movements of animal and human population movements. I think I already mentioned about avian influenza, the fighting cocks. Animal management, like BSE, isn't it? Because they feed the animals. And also when the enclosure come in contact with fruit orchards and sharing of our environment. Will I stop? This wet market that I mentioned just now. That's why nowadays used to be when they keep the pig, the hens, the goats all in one place. Now they have to separate it. IHR, International Health Regulation, is come into being 2005. These are the previously they got, but these are revised versions. And they have accept Asia Pacific strategy for emerging diseases because WHO, even WHO thought that Asia Pacific is a epidemic center for emerging diseases. No? In this abstract, one of the area is zoonosis. No? These are term of reference, no? Sharing of surveillance information, coordinated response, risk reduction. I won't go into details. No? The way forward, capacity buildings. No? These are the surveillance system in Malaysia for, okay. This, because we contribute to the WHO, the circulating viruses. In order for them to develop a candidate for vaccine, they need what a virus that circulate in certain countries. These are part of the health education materials. I mentioned to you that every year we conduct a field simulation exercise. This involves DBS, Ministry of Health, and this year we will conduct in Kedah and also Langkawi involving Thailand. The southern part of Thailand, I think Satun, Songkla, if I'm not mistaken, the southern part of Thailand. So before the disease came to Malaysia shore, we already conducted simulation exercise. Ebola. These are the interface between the DBS and veterina. This, the one that I mentioned to you just now. As a medical doctor, in order for infectious disease to occur, they must have some exposure, isn't it? They must somebody bring to that disease to that person. So you need to ask three questions. No? The first one, geography. You must ask geography because where you live, where you work, part-time, also importance. Hobby, you may work in aircon condition, but your hobby, isn't it? Geography, location, where you eat, leptospirosis, you are dirty, E3, you can expose to this one. Where you travel, so important. And then timing. Talking about incubation periods, very important because when we're talking about MERS-CoV, we're talking about 21 days, talking about SARS, you know, you have to know the incubation period. And then practices, very important also to ask practices, if clothing, contact, swimming. You may live in, I said, Damansara, but you just have a picnic in Bukit Sungai Congkak, isn't it? Sungai Congkak is well known for leptospirosis, by the way. So you have to ask the disease, the history. So these are the questions that you need to ask. Then in terms of controls, okay, I got your body language, doctor. detection, I think I won't. Okay, these are challenges. I finished my talk. Okay, these are conclusions. Okay, any questions? I know that I already stopped about. Okay, yes, please. Make it short.